His southern pulpit with his southern accent. He clears his voice, clears his throat, and he announces, "This morning we are going to talk about race and reconciliation." And all over the sanctuary, the people wince. And under their breath, they beg, "Preacher, please don't do it. Oh, preacher, please, you're getting ready to open up a big can of worms." But the middle-aged preacher with a southern accent who has opened up more cans of worms than anyone can possibly count ignores the grimaces and metaphorically gets out the can opener. Ever since I've been a pastor, mostly in the South, church folks have urged me to avoid talking about race. They say if you talk about it, you're just going to stir things up. Make things worse. If you will just leave it alone, preacher, it will go away. And if you think about it, pastor, those who call attention to the color of their skin, why, they're the real racists. They need to stop saying that their lives matter and understand that all lives matter. Reconciliation Sunday? Really? Come on, preacher, we just need to let it go. And for the most part, when it comes to talking about race, we white preachers, especially in the South, have been very silent. But guess what? That don't seem to be working so good. The recent alt-right white nationalist march in Charlottesville was a stark reminder that racism in our country is not going away that easily. Yeah, many would rather still shut their eyes and close their ears, pretending that racism no longer exists. A couple of years ago, I had something interesting happen to me. It was when I first started working with Ainsley's Angels, and one of our, and if you get tired of it, just let me know. You're not getting tired of it. But one of my jobs as ambassador with Ainsley's Angels is to use social media. To put pictures of our races and our events on social media. You have to do something, you have to make a post like once a week on social media. And someone, one of my friends, blocked me right after I started doing that. Just blocked me on Facebook. And when I asked a mutual friend, like, why did they block me? What happened? They responded, "Well, all those pictures that you were putting on Facebook with children that have special needs, children that had disabilities, well, it just made him very uncomfortable. So he watched. Out of sight, out of mind, we like to say. Let's not talk about it. Let's not bring it up. Let's close our ears, shut our eyes. And maybe this is why Jesus talked more about sight in the Gospels than Jesus ever talked about sin. Throughout the Gospels, Jesus asked over and over, "Do you have eyes and fail to see?" In our Gospel lesson this morning, Jesus quotes the prophet Isaiah, "You will indeed listen, but never understand, and you will indeed look, but not perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull, and their ears hard of hearing, and they have shut their eyes, so that they might not look with their eyes and listen with their heart." In chapter 6 of Isaiah, we read that closed minds and closed eyes and closed ears, closed hearts, ignoring injustice, looking the other way, tuning racism out, will lead to cities lying in waste without inhabitants, and houses without people, and the land utterly desolate. Refusing to listen to and to understand the cause of injustice, possessing hearts that are dull and indifferent, leads to complete desolation, says Isaiah. It leads to tiki torches in Charlottesville, a shooter in Charleston, voter suppression in North Carolina, an assassination in Memphis, Jim Crow in the South, a Holocaust in Germany, and a mass lynching of 237 African Americans right here in Arkansas. Isaiah continues, even if a tenth part remains in it, it will be burned again, like an oak whose stump remains standing when it is felled. But then listen to the good news from Isaiah chapter 6. This passage concludes, the holy seed is its stump. There's a holy seed ready to sprout forth. In a land of deep darkness, a light shines forth. In the demise and the decay, there is the promise of new life. Like a candle flickering in the dark, hope is still burning, like a stream trickling in the desert. Reconciliation is still possible. And Jesus suggests that the key to reconciliation, the key to healing and redemption, is open eyes, open ears, open minds, and open hearts. The mission of Answers Angels, the reason that I have to blow up Facebook every week, or try to blow it up, and by blow it up, I mean just post a lot of pictures, try to get a lot of likes, get some shares. The mission of Answers Angels is exactly what Jesus is talking about here. Our primary mission as Answers Angels is raising awareness. Awareness, says Jesus, is having God-blessed eyes and God-blessed ears. Because whether you're talking about ableism or racism or any other ism, awareness is what is needed before reconciliation can happen. And with this blessed awareness that Jesus wants us to have, what is it specifically that Jesus wants us to see? What do we see for Jesus to respond, blessed are your eyes, for they see? Prophets and righteous people have longed to see what you see but did not see it. What's he trying to get us to see? Well, I believe the answer is in Jesus' first recorded sermon. In Matthew chapter 5, we read where Jesus went up to a mountain and he taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. God bless us, see that the poor in spirit and the meek are blessed by God. Not the one who has never had a reason to doubt that God was for them, not against them, with them, not away from them. But God blessed eyes see that God is on the side of the ones who have been degraded and dehumanized by systems and structures of the privileged. Their spirits have been crushed by inequitable education, poor health care, discrimination in the workplace, racial profiling in the streets. But their future, says Jesus, is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. God blessed eyes see that God empathizes with the mourners. Not the ones that the Apostle Paul is talking about when he says that we should give thanks in all circumstances or rejoice in the midst of suffering. But those who have a difficult time finding anything in this world for which to be thankful, for them there is no rejoicing. And they're not just complaining about the pain in their life, they're actually mourning over that pain. They look at how their parents and their grandparents were valued by this world. They see how their lives are valued. And they look into the eyes of their children or their grandchildren, their nephews and their nieces, and they grieve for them. But because Jesus knows that love will win and evil will be overcome, Jesus calls them blessed and promises comfort. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Not the ones who are righteous, but the ones on whose behalf the prophet Amos preached, "Let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream." This is everyone who has been marginalized by culture, even by communities of faith. They have suffered great injustices just for being different. They have been bullied so badly by the world that they hunger and they thirst for justice and righteousness like a wanderer in the hot desert thirsts for water. And Jesus says they are blessed. And they are the ones who will not only be satisfied, they will be filled, their cups running over. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Not the pure, but the pure in heart. Not those who look like you do on the outside. Not those who share your skin tone. No, God blesses those who dream with the Reverend Dr. King for a world where they will be judged not by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. God bless eyes see. God bless eyes have the grace to see others as the Lord sees them. We read in 1 Samuel chapter 16, "For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. God sees them for who they truly are, beloved children of God, created in the image of God. And they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God." Not the ones who have necessarily found peace for themselves, but God blesses those who are tormented, the discriminated and the victimized, who because their lives are so continuously in chaos, seek to make peace whenever and wherever they can. Blessed are those who live with no peace but seek it, because they will find a home and a peace that is beyond all understanding within the household of God. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Not the proud, not the boastful and the arrogant, not the ones who never admit to any mistake, those who say that they are the least racist person, or they don't have a racist bone in their body. But God blesses the one who are fully aware of their prejudices. The ones who have made mistakes, terrible mistakes, the ones who are continually making those same mistakes, and they know it. Thus, when they encounter others who are also suffering from this fragmented world, they have mercy and they have compassion. In their hearts, there's always room for others. They give mercy because they need mercy for themselves. And Jesus says, they will receive it. Do we have eyes to see what Jesus wants us to see? What's the one thing that we need more than anything else in order to see? We need light. Can't see without light. And the good news is that the Lord announces, "I have come as light, as the light of the world." And not only that, Jesus says, "You, all of you who are here this morning, who are seeking to be my disciples, who are seeking to be my hands and my feet in this world, you're not only a burned out stump with holy semen. You are also light. You are the lights of this world. And you are called not to hide your light, but to shine your light so all the world may see God's creation as God sees it." We are to shine our lights by lifting up, accepting, and caring for all people, especially those who are often left behind. We are to light it up by defending and caring for those whose spirits have been broken, those who mourn and need mercy, the marginalized who hunger and thirst for justice, the discriminated who seek equity, and the troubled who yearn for peace. So as lights of this world, for the sake of this creation, may First Christian Church of Fort Smith light our city and our state up. So crushed spirits can have new life. Light it up so the despairing can have hope. Light it up so those who ache for fairness can be satisfied. Light it up so that victims of all kinds of discrimination will see God. Light it up so those who yearn for peace will receive justice and know peace. Light it up until the day comes when the eyes and the ears of all are finally and fully blessed, and the entire human race be reconciled.